Hi guys, in this lesson I'm going to discuss the deployment options and volume types for the Elastic Block Store EBS. So here's a diagram just showing you some of the potential ways you can use EBS volumes. In this case we have two availability zones, and you can see that we have instances attached to volumes within the availability zone. We also have an instance here that's attached to multiple EBS volumes. Now, there's limited support for attaching multiple instances to an individual volume. So with a standard EBS volume, you cannot do this, but there is something called EBS Multi-Attach, which I'll cover in the next slide. But traditionally, you haven't been able to, and I don't think you're going to see anything coming up in the exam on Multi-Attach. I haven't seen anything yet, but I'm sure it will come at some point. EBS volumes are replicated within an availability zone, so you have that durability within an AZ. Now, the instances must be in the same AZ as the EBS volume, and that's the same whether you're using multi-attach or not. So let's have a look at multi-attach. This literally just means that you can attach multiple EC2 instances to a single EBS volume. Now, there are some limitations. It's available for Nitro system-based EC2 instances. You can have up to 16 instances attached to a single EBS volume, and it must be a provisioned IOPS IO1 volume. The volume and the instances are within a single availability zone as well, so this is not crossing availability zones. So there are going to be some use cases where this is a useful solution. Of course, EFS, the Elastic File System, is a way that you can mount a file-based storage system to multiple instances. You can do so with fewer of these limitations, and you can do so across availability zones and also attach up to thousands of instances at a time. So EFS volumes are going to suit a lot of use cases. There will be some use cases for EBS multi-attach as well. But like I said, as far as I know, it's not on the exam yet, so you probably won't see this coming up. But just to let you know, it is coming. So let's look at this table here from AWS, which talks about the various different volume types. Now, I've got a couple of things to tell you about this first as well. So we've got some new volumes here. We've got GP3s, and we've got the IO2 and the IO2 Block Express. Now, these are very new. They were announced in 2020 at the AWS reInvent. I believe that some of these are available now. I think the Block Express is in preview. I think IO2 and GP3 are actually available to use. So these are very new, and again, they're not going to be on the exam quite yet, but after 6 months or so after general availability, that's about when you can start imagining that they'll turn up on the exam. So the key volume types that we're looking at here for SSD-backed volumes, these are all SSD-backed. The ones which have been around for a while, the ones that come up on the exam currently, are the IO1 and the GP2. So the GP2 is the general purpose SSD. This is what you have with your instance when you just launch an on-demand instance without actually changing anything. It's the default. Good for low latency apps. The volume sizes can be 1 gigabyte to 16 terabytes. Now, the max IOPS per volume is 16,000. So take a note of that. That's the kind of thing that can come up on the exam questions, where they'll give you a use case and tell you how many IOPS are required and ask you to choose the correct volume type. So you've got to remember the max volume sizes and the IOPS. Now, IO1 and GP2 actually have the same max volume size, so that's not really something to worry about too much, but the IOPS will come up. Now, the other thing is you've got throughput. So we measure performance in two principal ways. One is the IOPS, the IO per second, and then we have the actual throughput per volume. So you can see the different throughput available here. EBS multi-attach is not supported, as you can see here, but it is supported for the IO1. So the IO1 is where you require more sustained IOPS. If you need more than the 16,000 IOPS that you can get from a GP2, then you must go with an IO1. You can also get up to 64,000 IOPS per volume in total. Now, the other types of volumes are the HDD-backed volumes. So these are the hard disk drives, whereas the other ones were the solid state drives. Now, these are the ST1 and the SC1. So you've got the cold HDD and the throughput optimized HDD. Now, you can get reasonable throughput from these, but you really don't get much in the way of IOPS performance. So 500 IOPS and 250 IOPS per volume, which is really low. So you wouldn't want to use those for any kind of workload that has any kind of sustained IOPS requirements. However, if your workload is throughput oriented and infrequently accessed, or you just need a really low cost storage solution on an EBS volume, then you might go with the cold. And you can get a bit better performance, so you can actually run some big data and data warehouses and log processing on the throughput optimized HDD, but just remember the limitations in performance there. You wouldn't want to do it for anything that requires any serious kind of performance at all. And again, note that neither of these are supported for multi-attach, and neither of them are supported for booting either. Whereas if we go back to the SSDs, you'll note that all of them can be boot volumes. So one thing I want to do now, just head over to the console and quickly show you a few more things in the console. So in EC2, I'm going to head down to Elastic Block Store, choose volumes, and let's look at creating a volume. So the first option here, GP2, is the default. Now note that you get a baseline of 3 IOPS per gigabyte, and then you get a minimum of 100 IOPS and burstable to 3000, and it uses a system of credits. Now that means that if I put the volume size up to 1000, then we get 3000 IOPS. And what if I put it up to 8,000, then we get 16,000 IOPS. And if I go up a bit further, we don't get any more. So I can go up to, for instance, 10,000, and I still get 16,000, because remember, that's the limitation. So let's look at the other volume types we've got here. So the other one that's of key importance for the exam is the IO1, and that's where you can then specify the amount of IOPS you want. So let's say we want 1,000 gigabyte volume. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and go with 64,000 IOPS, because that's the maximum. And I can't, because it tells me there's a maximum ratio of 50:1. So what about if I change that for 50,000? 50,000 works. Change it to 50,001. Obviously, that doesn't work. So you've got that maximum ratio. Now, let's have a look at the other ones just for interest. So we've got the GP3. So here's the GP3. And again, you can actually choose the IOPS on this one. So that's not something you can do with the GP2. Remember, it calculates them for you based on the size of your volume. But with GP3, this is a new thing. You can now actually specify not just the IOPS, but the throughput. You see that you can actually choose IOPS and throughput separately. Now, as with all of these, you choose an availability zone, you can choose a snapshot, and you can also encrypt the volume and choose your master key. You can do that with any of these volume types. And we can also change to IO2, so this is the IO2 volumes. Now, note that these are the HDDs, and we do also have the old magnetic standard here. So this is something that you can actually have as an HDD, which is a boot volume. And it's not even mentioned in the tables anymore. So it's obviously being deprecated. Quite a while ago now, AWS changed the standard disk with your EC2 launch to be a GP2 rather than the magnetic. You can still go with the cold, and you can still use the throughput optimized as well. But of course, these can't be boot volumes. So that's all I wanted to show you. Hope that was useful. See you in the next lesson.